name is Christopher James. I work with the Lesbian, Gay, Bisexual Student Services Program here on campus, and I wanted to let people know about a couple of events that are coming up later in the week. There's a brochure in the back. It says Celebrating Stonewall 25 on it, has a list of all of the events for this week. After this discussion, the lecture and questions this evening, there will be a reception at Bukalan's restaurant, and tomorrow Elias will also be speaking in the Pioneer Room at 12 o'clock on queer spirituality and traditional cultures. There's also a bisexual group that is meeting from 5 to 6 in the Women's Center on Thursday, and that evening comedian Lynn Labner will be in the maintenance shop, and there will be a reception afterwards in the Bukalan's restaurant. Friday there will be a rally on Central Campus at noon. The RAIN location, I believe, is the South Ballroom, in case there's in case it's rained out. And there will be a dance on Saturday night. So anyone who wants more information, that is available. The schedules are available in the back. Last February, I attended a conference, and it was the Because Conference, Bisexual Empowerment and United Supportive Experience. That conference is a regional conference, and will be held again this year in April in Minneapolis. At that event, Dr. Elias Farajaje-Jones was a keynoter, and it was the first chance that I had to meet and to hear Elias speak. The person who first introduced him first talked about Elias's credits, and they were extensive, I'd say a bit overwhelming. I can give you a sense of what they were. Elias identifies as a Spanish-speaking African Native American, is an anarchist, guerrilla theologian, AIDS terrorist, writer, cultural critic, performance artist, ritual technician, a queer-identified bisexual man who lives in Washington, D.C. Elias graduated as one of the first two men of African descent from Vassar College at the age of 19, went on to do a master's degree in Eastern Christianity, which he earned magna cum laude. He went on to do his doctorate in history of religions at the University of Bern in Switzerland, and was also the first African in diaspora ever to receive the doctorate in history of religions from the University of Bern. Dr. Elias Farajaje-Jones is the author of In Search of Zion, a study of the significance of Africa for three black religious movements, and co-editor of African Creative Expressions of the Divine, African Religions in Diaspora. He is currently finishing a book, Silent Tears, that deals with AIDS, homophobia, biphobia, erotophobia, and the black religious communities. He is currently a tenured professor at the Howard University School of Divinity, where besides history of religions and sociology of religions, he teaches multiculturalism, sociology of AIDS, sociology of heteropatriarchy, and gender studies. He is faculty advisors to OXLA, a newly formed Howard University lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender student group. He's also the co-founder of numerous queer people of color organizations in DC, AMBI, Moving Violations, and Ambush. He lives in an anarchist womanist community created with his life partner, Zawadi, a queer-identified bi-African, and Catherine, a queer-identified bi-woman of color, and himself. He is an AIDS widow, Zawadi having died in 1992. Giving the credits for Elias doesn't necessarily do him justice. The person introducing him last time followed with a string of superlatives about how wonderful, how unique, and how genuine he is. And I thought it had to be overkill, had to be exaggeration. Nobody could live up to that intro. Yet after listening to him and after having the honor of being a friend to Elias, I have to say that he earns his superlatives. And you have a chance to judge based on your own perspective. Please help me welcome Dr. Elias Farajaje.
Thank you. But I want to thank Chris for the introduction and for all of his effort in bringing me here. And thank you all for coming out, because I know that there are plenty of other things you could do of a, what day is it, Wednesday? Of a Wednesday evening than be here. I want to just share with you a couple of reflections on racism, sexism, and heterosexism, or more aptly put, white supremacy, male supremacy, and heterosupremacy. But I want to start by using some words from Sojourner Truth. She started by saying, "May I say a few words?" And it is thus that she began her famous "Ain't I a Woman" speech, which she delivered at the 1851 Women's Rights Convention in Akron, Ohio. "I want to say a few words about this matter. I am for women's rights. I have as much muscles as any man and can do as much work as any man. I have plowed and reaped and husked and chopped and mowed, and can any man do more than that? I have heard much about the sexes being equal. I can carry as much as any man and can eat as much too, if I can get it. I'm as strong as any man that is now. You need not be afraid to give us our rights for fear we will take too much. Poor men seem to be all in confusion and don't know what to do. Why, children, if you have women's rights, give it to her and you will feel better. Women are coming up, and a few of the men are coming up with them. But the white man is in a tight place. The poor slave is on him. Woman is coming on him. He is surely between a hawk and a buzzard." I greet you with the Yoruba word ashe, a word that means the power to make things happen. It got warm all of a sudden. A word that we use in the Yoruba religion in response and in rituals. And I also greet the four directions and ask permission of our Native American ancestors and sisters and brothers, the people indigenous to this place, ask their permission to be present here, to gather on their soil and to be near their waters. What we discuss now as we move into celebrating 25 years of Stonewall, we must discuss in the light of the fact that we are a community under siege, whether we want to believe it or not. But the religious right, or the religious wrong, as I call it, has across the country mounted a full-scale attack against our community. Now that communism is no longer the red beast, they've been able to focus all their attention on us. And if we are to survive and creatively resist the Christian right, we are going to have to build progressive, broad-based, multifocal coalitions. But if we're to struggle for a society based on justice, on equality, on access, on liberation and peace for everyone, and not just in a way that is a reaction to the Christian right, but proactively, because we really do believe in the value of justice, in the value of equality, and of peace, then we must move and create our own agenda. Not just an agenda that is merely a reaction to the right. We must be about defining our own realities. Now, I began by using the words of Sojourner Truth, asking to say a few words, but my words, as those of Sojourner Truth, whom I use because she is a womanist, liberationist shero for me, are words rooted in a growing sense of urgency. We are running out of time. Time for what, you might very well ask me. We are running out of time to do the work, as Audre Lorde so often and so emphatically said, that we must do. I am a two-spirit person, as my native ancestors would say, or a queer-identified bisexual man of African and Native American
Cherokee descent.
There are people in my family who have Spanish as their first language. There are Jews in my family. And I live in a committed, polyfidelitous relationship with a dyke-identified bisexual woman, or a bike, as a friend says. Of color. And I'm also an AIDS widow. My partner, Zawadi, having died of complications resulting from HIV and AIDS in 1992. But more precisely, having died because the Veterans Administration Hospital decided that he, as a queer black man with AIDS, did not need to live anymore. In 1990, we waited 36 hours in an overcrowded VA hospital waiting room. Although diagnosed with pneumocystis, Zawadi was given Sudafed, and we were sent home. During the night or early the next morning, I don't remember at what point it was, he turned purple, and we had to return to the hospital. The ambulance wouldn't take him to the hospital, and so a friend came and drove us there. And although he was finally admitted because we had doctor friends, I could not help but think that if we had not had those kind of friends, he might have died even earlier than he did. But this is the daily fate of poor people in a country that does not have universal health care. Zawadi had no health care insurance, and the VA was the only place where he could go. The night that he died, the doctors reluctantly finally conceded that he did need to be placed in the intensive care unit. But they said they had no more beds in the intensive care unit. When we pushed them on the matter, we got loud and nasty, they all of a sudden had a bed. But instead of sending down the regular intensive care unit transfer team the way they do it, they made me push his bed up to ICU. And he died as I was pushing him to the doors of the intensive care unit, probably only about 10 feet from the swinging doors that led into ICU. And as though that were not enough, when he died, the ultimate insult was that the VA would not release his body to me because I, the person who had taken care of him, I was not family. In the words of a song by Sweet Honey in the Rock, are there any rights I'm entitled to? I also have an adopted son who was an 18-year-old black gay man living with HIV. And I live in what we call a colonial territory, also known as the District of Columbia, which might any day be under occupation by the National Guard. And besides being the only out queer professor in all of Howard University, which is a big university, I am engaged as an artist, as a cultural critic, and as an agitator, all of which cross inform each other. I have described myself as a guerrilla theologian, for the true work of liberation is to be done in the struggle and not exclusively in the comfort of the academy. It should be apparent that I refuse to be defined by others. I refuse to be told what I can and cannot be, that I cannot be both something and something else. We are not minorities. I'm really fed up this week with keep hearing about minority issues. We are not minorities, neither as women, neither as people of color, nor as queer people. Together, we are all the majority. And we might be marginalized, we might be oppressed, we might be historically made silent, we might be historically made invisible, but we are not minorities. Many of us have complex identities, being more than one thing at a time, being many things, or too many things, as we say in the black queer community. And it's high time that we stop apologizing and begin to celebrate that. People of color issues are lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender issues, because there are people of color in the queer community. It's as simple as that. I can sit down after having said that. That explains it all. Lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender issues are people of color issues because there are what? Lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender people in the people of color communities. As Audre Lorde always said, there can be no hierarchy of oppressions. But the so-called progressive community, like the white man of the time of Sojourner Truth, is now torn over whether we have to deal with the multiplicity and interconnectedness of oppressions, or whether we can just deal with one issue. And everyone always says, what's just too much, I don't want to overload, I don't have energy for this issue, and I just have too much on my plate, I can't deal with all of these issues. Well, damn it, get a new plate. We don't have the choice anymore. As Harriet Tubman would say, you have to come along or get out of the way. And that's the purpose of coalitions. We don't have to individually do all of the work. Yet some of us don't have the luxury of sitting around and processing this, because we live at the intersection of oppressions. And the polemics of the Christian right, believe me, as well as the thinking of the queer community, does not usually take this into account. Why? Because all of these groups forget that there are queer people of color. To paraphrase the, you know, the book title, All the Women Are White, All the Blacks Are Men, But Some of Us Are Brave. Well, I paraphrase that. Queers are white, all the people of color are straight and homophobic, but some of us are fierce queer. Throughout this country, marginalized peoples are pitted one against the other as we compete for crumbs falling from the master's tables. And we fight each other instead of saying together that we don't want crumbs, that we want the whole thing. In fact, we are going to make a new cake in which we all can share. Now, this reality is very clear on campuses throughout this country. Instead of seeing that our work must at times be together, we spend inordinate amounts of energy fighting against each other. And unfortunately, in most places in this country, queer student groups are predominantly white. This allows the queer students, read white queer students, to say that people of color communities are homophobic and therefore it's impossible to work with them. And it allows the students of color to say that queerness is a white thing and therefore cannot possibly entail any type of oppression, therefore why work in coalition with these people? Just as some people can say that feminism is a white thing, especially since many white feminists do not know about Native American shapes of feminism or history and experience of Native American women or Asian Pacific Islander forms or the ways in which feminism is articulated in people of African descent cultures in their diversity. But it also makes students of color have to go through a process of what I call internal exile. If you are a queer student of color and you decide that you want to be out and active in the queer community, that will usually mean that you will be marginalized by the student of color community, which is usually the only environment in which you don't feel totally out of it. But if you have to be closeted even in that context, then you do end up being someone other than who you really are and therefore out of it. This is a terribly insidious form of oppression. People who are not queer don't realize the toil that it takes on people to have to constantly lie, to have to constantly be someone else, to have to constantly change pronouns, to constantly rearrange stories, to leave out whole portions of your lives, to not introduce people to their friends. And imagine losing your life partner and having to go back to work after the memorial service because you could never tell your job that this person was your life partner, first of all, and that she or he had AIDS or breast cancer or ovarian cancer or had been the victim of a crime of homo-hatred or of queer bashing. People who are not queer do not understand that 30% of youth suicides are believed to be related to sexual orientation. And that's not just a crazy figure that I made up, that comes from the Journal of Primary Prevention. This high rate of suicide among queer teens exists because many of our youth feel that death is the only option for them. And people would rather think that it has something to do with being queer than having something to do with the fact that society tells us that we should not exist. I ask again, are there any rights I'm entitled to? It is not that people of color communities are more homophobic than the dominating culture. We are not the ones that brought to the world religiously justified homo-hatred. But our communities are our only safe space from the constant oppression and marginalization of the dominating culture. And when those safe spaces are no longer safe spaces for those of us who are queer, we feel that pain more acutely because there is no broader culture into which we can just disappear. But this does mean that we must challenge the heterosexism and heteropatriarchy of our own people of color communities as well. Let heterosexual allies not only come and speak to us, letting us know, you know, how cool, how progressive, how anti-homo hatred they are, as we grovel at their feet, you know, because of our internalized homophobia. When a straight person comes and speaks to us, or a straight person does something, it's so much better than if one of our own did it for us, and we just kind of grovel and pander, and we're just so glad these straight folks are interested in us. If they are really our allies, let them go to their heterosexual communities, okay, and challenge heterosexism there. Now, for example, we cannot allow someone like a Buju Banton. You know who Buju Banton is, right? No. Okay. Buju Banton is a Jamaican dance hall singer. And if you read Vibe magazine, my coastalism is coming in. Right? I know. Check out Vibe magazine. I think it was from in the summer. And this is interesting. This is a publication. The editor, the chief editor, is a white gay man. And they did an article on Buju Banton, who's a Jamaican dance hall musician, a very, very popular musician in Jamaica and in the Jamaican diaspora, but who wrote a dance hall song about queer bashing. There was a call from the black queer leadership in the United States. We wrote a letter to Biden, like 5 million people signed this letter. Stating that the article about Buju Banton was unacceptable because the article basically excused him for what he said, saying, well, this is a, you know, a black Jamaican man, you have to understand him in this context, and so on and so forth. It's important for us to say that we can't let him sing songs of homo-hatred that incite people to murder queers and then say, well, it's okay, because he's a black man from a particular context, in much the same way that we're not going to explain away Hitler or say, well, you know, you have to, he was a frustrated artist, and you have to understand him. You see, many people believe that it's all right to be openly lesbophobic or homophobic. Indeed, expressing homophobia and biphobia to reaffirm heterosexual privilege is often the only situation in which many people of color feel that they have any form of privilege at all. However, as is the case with male justification of crimes of violence against women, it is considered that we queers are provoking violence against us in supposedly straight men by the mere fact of our existence. And to many, queer bashing is justified, often on the basis of religion, because our behavior is perceived as having provoked it. Are there any rights we're entitled to? It's the same kind of reasoning that says that if women dress or walk in a certain way, they're provoking men to rape them. In this way of thinking, it's all right to beat up and or kill lesbians, gay men, bisexual, transgender women and men, for the simple reason that they might have dared to hold hands in public. And this is all the more the case with violence against lesbians and bisexual women. Their very existence places in an extremely precarious position the assumption that women can only have identity through their association with men. Lesbians and bisexual women are the ultimate threat to the heteropatriarchal fantasy. So this is yet another example of the power of heterosexual men over women, over queers, a power inextricably bound up with our capitalist class structure, fed by white supremacy, classism, male supremacy, erotophobia, and heterosexual supremacy. Heterosexism is profoundly rooted in a primal need to preserve these social structures and strictures. How can this be anything other than oppression? You see, the whole line of the religious right is that we're always talking about oppression. And what they do now is they try to co-opt the African-American community and other people of color communities to say, what did they do? They've made a movie now about us called, they've gone beyond the gay agenda, that's old already. Now they have gay rights special rights. That is to appeal to the people of color communities. And they talk about the basic African-American income is such and such. Gays and lesbians make, our average income is $55,000 a year. We've all gone to travel abroad at least 3 times in the past, and so on and so forth. We have houses, condos, et cetera, and so forth. And every time I see it, I'm like, where's my money? Where's my trip? But the point of that is to evacuate any sense of oppression or acknowledging any sense of oppression of our community. Because if that oppression is acknowledged, what happens? The frightening thing happens then that we might begin to work in solidarity. We might make coalition, and that would threaten the patriarchy in much the same way that during slavery, black women who did all the things that women were not supposed to do. Because in the 19th century, the ideal of Victorian womanhood, women weren't supposed to be able to work in fields, women weren't supposed to be able to toil, and all those things that Sojourner Truth listed. Women were not supposed to do those things. But black women did those things because they worked in the fields. Now you can imagine the white women sitting in the plantation thinking, wait a minute, I'm just sitting locked up in this house all the time, and I'm a woman, they're women, so what happened? The patriarchy made it very clear that these were subhuman beings. Because otherwise, a coalition would have arisen that would have threatened the power of the patriarchy. But how can all of these things under which we live, how can this be anything other than oppression? As a queer man of color, I have rights that are rights. They're not special rights, but they are my rights. Not special rights, but my inalienable rights. Not special rights, but human rights. My human rights as a human being, which should be upheld by this country that was built of land that was stolen from my Native American ancestors, and built in the blood, sweat, and bitter tears of my ancestors brought from Africa and the Caribbean. And as a generic queer, if you want to imagine that, I have the same rights as anyone else in this country, and I deserve and demand to have those rights guaranteed by any means necessary. Aren't there any rights I'm entitled to? This country has now participated in the process of facilitating bringing down the Berlin Wall, facilitated the Palestinian-Israeli Accords, the de Klerk Mandela actions, yet we as queers in this country still have no guarantee for the protection of our basic human rights. Aren't there any rights I'm entitled to? People who take for granted their privilege as heterosexuals do not realize that we queers can still be denied, refused housing, the right to live with our life partners, lovers,
that we could still be denied, refused employment, lose jobs if we were lucky enough to get them in the first place, denied, refused insurance, denied health care, denied, refused custody of our children, put in mental hospitals and prisons, which are concentration camps for many of us, especially people of color. That sounds like discrimination to me. That sounds like oppression to me. That sounds like denying a group of people the right to self-determination to me. Aren't there any rights I'm entitled to? Now, if you want to say that I am not a human being and that I have no rights, if you are a straight person of color saying that, how are you any different from a white person that says the same thing about you? And if you are a man saying that about women, how are you any different than those who would deny you your rights because of who you are? And if you are saying that people with AIDS deserve to have AIDS, how is that any different from people saying that colored folk deserve to be in prison and be executed? Why is it that if we are queer and we talk about queer issues as a normal part of our conversation, we are portrayed as always and only talking about queer things? If we are Jewish and bring up Jewish issues, we're always talking about Jewish things. Or if we are women and we do it, we are always only talking about women's things. Or if we are poor, working class people and bring up those issues that are pertinent to us, then that is all we ever talk about. Or if we are people of color, we are always talking about racism, complaining, and whining. Not acting like men, quote unquote, whatever that means. Aren't there any rights I'm entitled to? And does not the chief character in Falling Down spend the entire film whining? Now, sexism, the belief in the inherent superiority of men over women, and therefore men's right to dominate, and heterosexism, the belief in the inherent superiority of heterosexuality, narrowly defined, to all other ways of loving, and therefore its right to dominate, which also silences our allies for fear of what might be said about them, happen to them or their families. These isms have the same root as racism, which is the belief in the superiority of one race over all others, and therefore its right to dominance. They are all rooted in the belief in the superiority and dominance of one group, whatever that group is, over all others. Anti-Muslim oppression, anti-Jewish oppression, anti-pagan oppression are all connected to racism, to fear and hatred of women, fear of the power of the erotic, heterosexism, and homo-hatred. As queers, as women, as people of color, we hardly ever see healthy images of ourselves in popular culture and media. I'm really tired of seeing these movies of supposedly lesbian or bisexual women who are psychopaths. And it's interesting, they're rich, they're powerful, and therefore they're crazy because women ain't supposed to have that much money or that much power, and they're driving out of their mind. I'm tired of never seeing myself in movies, and that's why I decided I want to make movies in my spare time. Because I'm not a rich, white, heterosexual man. I'm not a crack dealer. I don't live in South Central LA. Nor am I a rich, white, gay man with more than one place to live and with a very antiseptic relationship. Now, how could one not speak of the oppression of lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender people of color and its intersections with racism? What about the fact that those of us who are queers of color live at a place of intersection of different forms of oppression? In our experience of otherness, we are doubly or triply or quadruply or more than that, the ultimate other. the different one, all caps. As a black queer man, I'm oppressed as a black man, I'm oppressed as a queer, as a bisexual queer, and as a black bisexual queer. And my oppression comes not just from the dominating culture, but also from within my own communities. In the people of color communities, I'm oppressed for being queer. In the Spanish-speaking community, I'm oppressed for looking and acting too black. In the queer community, I'm marginalized and oppressed because I'm a bisexual and a man of color. That's a lot. Most people don't even think of the history that during the Inquisition and on down throughout the years, European Christians killed same-sex identified women and men, or those whom they perceived to be same-sex identified. You know, it's not necessary to actually be same-sex identified to be persecuted. It need only be in the eyes of the persecutor or leveled as an accusation. And a link was established between heretic, sorcerer, witch, queer, in short, anybody who was perceived as going against the norm or anyone you wanted to get rid of so that you could have their land and money or potential for making money, women healers and midwives. And with the Spanish invasion of the Americas in the 15th century, intense persecution and execution began of those Native Americans who were perceived as being same-sex identified. And it's not surprising that later generations of Native Americans would steadfastly deny the existence of anything remotely resembling same-sex activities in their culture. During the Holocaust, the Nazis used the black triangle to designate antisocial woman, a category which included commercial sex workers and lesbians. The pink triangle being used for gay men. The total number of queers who died in the Holocaust must have been several tens of thousands. And this in a country that in the years before the Nazi regime had a vibrant and brilliant queer community, not unlike ours today. And to silence this persecution of queers throughout history is to condemn us to die twice. It's parallel to what we call the paper genocide, by which indigenous peoples of Central and South America are simply no longer listed as Native American. Many people in our people of color communities try to argue even now that it's not necessary to deal with homophobia or biphobia in order to deal with AIDS. They maintain that this emphasis on tearing down homophobia and biphobia and acknowledging the existence of homosexualities and bisexualities obscures the real issues and alienates those good, wholesome, normal, morally upright people who are willing to work with those poor people living with AIDS, or as people usually say, AIDS victims or AIDS sufferers. Now, if we try to move as people of color into queer space, we come up against the racism of a predominantly white male-dominated queer world. When we consider tensions on campuses and in the broader culture between queer groups and people of color groups, it is important to look at history in order to understand what is going on and not merely cast people of color as backward, antiquated homophobes. This will make people of color communities all the more susceptible prey for the religious right. You see, no one believed when I began to speak and write about this 2 years ago. In fact, the head of a prominent press in this country said that I was delusional, that I was making wild and unfounded allegations, and now the religious right has proved my point is openly courting African-American churches. When black people and other people of color compare their struggle with those of queers, who seem to have been able to mobilize and crystallize attention around their issues very quickly, they cannot help but think that it must be easier or better than being a person of color. This, of course, does not at all, again, take into account the existence of people of color who are queer. But unfortunately, they are often closeted in their context. So when queers compare their struggle to that of the civil rights movement, it is understandable that African Americans should be deeply offended. Because often the queer movement does not acknowledge the fact that its language, its organizational tactics, its symbology, its rhetoric, all come from the Black civil rights movement. And this is complicated by the fact that it might appear to some that some institutions, like schools, for example, will more easily go out of their way to deal with heterosexism than they will to deal with racism and issues of racial justice. And unfortunately, some institutions will mask their homo-hatred by using the Black folks or the people of color, saying that, well, you know, we can't do that because that will upset the people of color. You know, they're kind of sensitive around these issues. Never having asked the people of color community how those communities felt about the particular issue, but it allows them, they can hide behind that and protect themselves also from the threat of racism. People of color, we must acknowledge, people of color in this society are still by and large invisible and silenced. We still don't have access. The media doesn't pay much attention to our issue. Where there is no hierarchy of oppressions, a false hierarchy has been created. So how can queers go to people of color communities and ask for support in queer issues when they've never paid any attention to the struggles of people of color? Even the people of color with whom they sleep, live, party, coexist, or just fuck. So if queer space is going to talk about its oppression, then it must talk about the ways in which it oppresses its own, whether that be on the basis of race, gender, class, ability, HIV status, or looks. For example, deaf queers and queers living with other disabilities are considered consistently only as an afterthought. And we organize queer color activities and often do not even think of Native American Two-Spirit people except as an afterthought, if at all. And we are the first queer people of this land. Why is so little attention paid to what is perhaps one of the most invisible, one of the most disempowered, one of the most silenced groups in the queer community? Queers in prison. Queers in prison live in conditions that are unimaginable to most of us. And many of these queers in prison are queers of color. What do we do about HIV and AIDS in the prisons? How much do we agitate for condoms and dental dams in the prisons, for clean needles, for HIV education? Where is our solidarity? Or are we silent because we believe that they should be there? That they are there because they did something wrong? If you are a person of color, if you are queer, if you are a queer person of color at that, you can very easily end up in prison in this country just because you are the wrong color. And if we don't look at this, we make it all the easier for some queer people of color to think that perhaps they have to make a choice, which is a false choice, between being queer and being a person of color. And not just talk about oppressions, and not just reflect on oppressions, but actively engage in our communities in anti-racism, anti-oppression work. Not long ago, I was talking to a prominent queer figure who had no idea that there is an annual National Black Lesbian and Gay Leadership Forum conference, which is attended by more than 1,000 queers of African descent from the United States and abroad. I've talked to white queers in DC, people that with whom I belong to ACT UP, who had no idea that because I'm black, it takes me hours to get a cab. It's unacceptable to me that people not know this, because whatever else we want to know, we find out. But we have to want to know. And we have to want to be involved with other people's issues out of an understanding, a real understanding that their oppressions are linked to ours. And not just because we want to go out and ask them to back us and give us their support and then drop them once we have the legislation or have defeated the initiative or whatever it is that we wanted to use them for in the first place. I am not an Asian Pacific Islander, but I will stop people's anti-Asian remarks cold when people say those Asians, lumping together hundreds of cultures and languages, some of which would not want to be uttered in the same breath. If people started about those Koreans, I share with them the paradox that young Koreans,
and I tried to show them that how they were parents, each in very particular ways, coming from very particular contexts. And it had never occurred to them that perhaps the reason that their group in DC was all white has something to do with racism. And of course, people want to think that if they're nice, then they are racism free. Well, maybe they need to look more closely at exactly what racism is and how it can manifest itself systemically in institutions. The same holds true for men working with women. If women's issues are truly important to us as men, then we will go and find out about them. I never tire of saying this, because we need to educate ourselves and not put women in the position of educating us. We will join in the struggle against rape and sexual harassment, against crimes of violence committed against women. We will see how the struggle for women's reproductive rights and their right to control their own bodies is connected to our struggles as queer men. We will make women and HIV a central issue in our agenda because 4 million women worldwide, 4 million, are expected to die of AIDS-related complications by the year 2000. 4 million women dead by the year 2000. We will learn about difficulties in access to health care for women, the politics of breast cancer, about ovarian cancer, about the feminization of poverty, because we want to know about these and other aspects of women's lives. This is the place from which real solidarity must begin. It's not enough to say that we've done our work on our sexism and we're not sexist like other men, because if that is true, why is it that so much of life is still male-dominated? Why is it that in most groups, even in many queer groups, men dominate? Why can we not accept the leadership of women, a leadership of women of color, in real and not token ways? And we have to look at ways in which we still hold on to our male privilege. Because even if we are queer males, we still have male privilege. How do we learn to let go of that privilege? What are ways in which we, for example, in a predominantly queer male group, agitate for the inclusion of women's issues? How many of us are really, honestly willing to call men on their sexist remarks or sexist behavior? How many of us are willing to point out the invisibility and silence of women in our groups? Or that many of our brothers simply refuse to and cannot and will not work with women? More importantly, how many of us even notice that that is a problem? Do we remain silent accomplices of the seemingly never-ending war against women, even when we know that the very homophobia that oppresses us is rooted in the fear and hatred of women and the fear and hatred of the power of the erotic? Now, the queer community has in many ways, in my eyes, forgotten its origin, forgotten our roots. Our present community was born out of the Stonewall Rebellion and uprising. Street guerrilla warfare. Not a tea dance, not a happy hour. A rebellion led by queer women and queers of color, drag queens, bull dykes, many of whom are the very people that our community now marginalizes because they get in the way of assimilating into the dominating culture. But who decided that assimilation into an oppressive, heteropatriarchal culture was what we wanted? This push towards assimilation makes, and you can look at all of our publications, it's so clear, makes us say that we're just like everybody else. Well, I don't want to be like everybody else. I don't want to be straight. I don't want to be tolerated or accepted. I don't want to be in the military. I want to ask why an imperialistic, capitalist, international police force military still exists. I don't want to be part of a military-industrial complex, but I do want to know why, in this country, the military still appears to be the only option for many poor queers, for many rural queers, for many people of color queers. Why have there never been any creative alternatives? We must stop organizing as though we were straight, as though we wanted to be straight. We must stop being apologetic and so damn accommodating. Does the heterocracy ever accommodate us? I want to lead my life as I choose and define myself and not be defined by others. The fear of the power of the erotic, erotophobia, in a society that is rooted in the policing of desire and the controlling of women's bodies for profit, has begun to make queers censor other queers about being too sexual, about their forms of sexuality as being too transgressive. Bisexuals face biphobia within the queer community. Some people find bisexuals an embarrassment just because the word sexual is in the name. We are also a threat to a monosexualist paradigm that says that you have to be either straight or gay. And this is the same kind of thinking that has led us in this country to creating a binary construction of race. You're either black or you are white. If you are anything else, you are other. You are forced to choose with which of the categories you want to identify. But this is not a choice that we should be forced to make. The whole area is so problematic for us today because we have based so much of our struggle for queer civil rights on the argument that we can't help ourselves, we were born this way. Perhaps in addition to this argument, we must, precisely out of our context as queers, challenge the way in which this country seems to think about who qualifies for having their rights assured and protected. Bisexuals, just like multiracial people, are here to stay and aren't going anywhere. And just as bisexuals are accused of having heterosexual privilege and the ability to pass, so multiracial people are said to be able to assimilate to white culture. But what about those people who don't use that privilege? What about those people who do everything in their power to make sure that they are consistently and publicly always identified as queer? I'm a queer-identified bisexual whose place is in the queer planet. And paradoxically, in my community, I am more often the object of homo-hatred than a lot of the closeted gay men I know. Now, the transgender community and the letter community are also marginalized within the queer world because they too stand in the way of joining the great white heterosexual host. The transgender community, in particular, fucks with people's notions of gender, makes them very uncomfortable, and especially men, because of the effeminophobia that exists amongst queer men. You know, you better butch it up. So we have reproduced all of the patterns of oppression of the dominating culture. If the religious right focuses on transgender people and letter people in their videos, then we run to answer them by saying, well, those people should not be allowed to be visible in our public manifestation as they ruin our reputation. We buy into the eroticophobia of the religious right, and we say that bisexual, transgender, and other people are just too blatantly sexual. Instead of challenging eroticophobia, we capitulate to it. And in that moment, we have let ourselves be defined by homophobic eroticophobes. Where is our self-definition? Where is our self-determination? And how can I tell my transgender and leather sisters and brothers to be invisible? Who am I to tell them to be silent? How can I tell myself to be invisible and silent? If we are not community to each other, then who will be? Are we so full of self-hatred and internalized homophobia that we can only see each other as traitors in our midst? And while we are processing and working through our issues, the religious right lumps us all together while we squabble about who really belongs. We need all of the community we can get. You see, the lesbian gay aristocracy has been lulled into a false sense of security and offers really no longer any reactionary response. And this makes it particularly difficult for us to organize now against the right, especially when some people feel that there's no real problem. People say, at least he, meaning Bill, talks about us. Well, damn it, with all the taxes that I pay, I want more than just at least he talks about us. The military decision passed without any highly visible, very vocal protest on our part. We must not believe that because Hillary, no matter how fabulous you might think her health reform policy or her hairdo are, because she and Bill are in the White House, that all is well with the world. The HIV ban on immigration, the Lonnie Guinier debacle, the upholding of the military ban, the war in Somalia, these are just a few things that should help us to see a bit more critically. We cannot help but stress that issues do not emerge in isolation within the movement. And some of us have focused almost exclusively on so-called gay civil rights and not looked at other places of oppression. Eroticophobia and racism intersect in the investment of people of color as the exotic and erotic other. People who are seen as the very incarnations of the erotic, incarnation of libido, and therefore of evil, like women, to be dominated, like the earth, to be dominated, because inferior and dangerous. Just as desire is to be policed, and women's bodies are to be controlled by men, so are people of color and the environment. And this erotophobia is killing us because it keeps us from talking about safer sex in terms that are unmistakably clear. Keeps us from distributing condoms and dental dams, leads us to exclusively advocate abstinence, tells people with HIV that they should not have sex anymore, yet at the same time, the marketing industry makes money using sex to sell everything from underwear to whiskey. Now, we queers are not the ones that put those images out there. I started out by talking about Sojourner Truth as icon. And we know that for Sojourner Truth, spiritual anarchist and womanist that she was, her issues as a woman of African descent and her issues as a woman were not seen in contradiction. They were inextricably bound up together. And we can do workshop after workshop about interconnectedness of oppression, solidarity, coalition building, but we must be able not only to understand this with our heads, but in our hearts. People ask me why I should be concerned about Tibet, or why I'm concerned about the plight of Ethiopian Jews, or about any people who are oppressed. As long as they are oppressed, I am oppressed. When Sojourner Truth delivered the Ain't I Woman speech, what she had to say about ending the oppression of women was not at the expense of ending the oppression of black people. For her, the two were inseparable, just as they were inseparable in her very person. Many of us are familiar with the phrase, never again, ni vida, in response to the Holocaust. And saying never again now means that we think of other peoples or other groups who are alienated and marginalized and oppressed, and we say with them, never again. Never again means that I stand in solidarity with all peoples who are exterminated because of their difference or their perceived otherness. Never again means that I struggle alongside all of those who are systematically excluded for whatever reason. Never again means that I stand in solidarity with the victims of neo-Nazism in Germany and in the United States. Never again means seeing how the struggle against racism is the struggle against classism, is the struggle against sexism, is the struggle against homo-hatred, is the struggle against ableism. And I am sure that if Sojourner Truth were here today, we would hear her say, and ain't I a Jew? And ain't I a lesbian? And ain't I a Palestinian? And ain't I a Bosnian? And ain't I an inner city dweller? And ain't I a poor farmer? And ain't I a person living with AIDS? And ain't I a homeless person? And ain't I a deaf person? And ain't I a Haitian? And ain't I a Hopi? And ain't I a woman? And she would be there at every march with us. She would be there doing civil disobedience and getting arrested. And she would be there challenging us constantly to be bolder freedom fighters. And she would be there being happy and not worried about what anybody thought about her. Sojourner Truth calls us to see how we can make coalition, how we can grow together, not just for fighting the right, but a growing together that is for liberation, for justice, for truth, for peace, for equality, and for just plain old fun. And when it's all over, when it's all over, I just hope that we can sing the words of Sojourner Truth. I ain't going to die, honey. I'm going home like a shooting star. Thank you.
I don't want to use the tactics of the religious right, okay? Because we're not organized enough, we don't have the money, we don't have the media access that they have to do it. But what I think we have to do, and that's why I talk always about self-definition or self-determination, is come out of the closet about our oppression and organize from that position, which is our position of strength. And not be apologetic about the fact that, yes, political correctness is important in our community. Not as a thing on a piece of paper, but because it reflects reality as we believe it should be. I gave a talk last week or 2 weeks ago for a group of Unitarian Universalist ministers and religious educators. And this one white man in the audience, when I got through, said, well, you know, that sounds like a caricature of PC. I said, well, I'm really sick and tired of hearing people complain about PC. Because if there were not, the only reason there has to be political correctness is because we live in a patriarchal, heteropatriarchal context where people have never paid attention to language. They've never paid attention to inclusion because they haven't had to. And that if all things were equal, then we wouldn't be in that situation. But I at least appreciate it because I don't have to be in the margins constantly anymore. And I think that when we come from that place, also ascendant, we are challenging. We're not, because we've been so focused on what we call gay civil rights, instead of being multi-focused and saying, we're challenging a whole bunch of shit, not just whether
we have the right to rent that apartment down the street, you know? And that makes us very subversive. Thank you. By the term queer, well, I use it for several reasons. I use it, first of all, because I can't stand the word homosexual. I'm not crazy about bisexual, because those are really scientific terms. I know I'm in a science university. Use my science phobia. I mean, it's extremely technical. And gay, to me, has come to represent a white gay male culture of a certain affluence and so on and so forth that is assimilationist. Whereas those who develop groups like Queer Nation or Queer Planet or Grassroots Queers use the term queer because it's a term that was used negatively against us that we say now we reappropriate and we use it. And by choosing to use it, it empowers us. And then for a very practical reason, because it spares me having to say, let's give us a chance to do
more.
When you mentioned the fact that you weren't a white male in an antiseptic relationship, were you implying that white males have antiseptic relationships?
No, I was talking about film. I was in context talking about film, and I was talking about how white gay men's relationships are portrayed in film. I knew someone was going to come for me on that.
There is a term, and I cannot remember it's a word that is used that encompasses homosexual and lesbian. Do you know what that word is? And I know I can't remember. Because usually when people are thinking about homosexuals, now people are understanding, or people, it will include the word lesbian in it as well. But there was a term that was used, and I can't seem to, I've been looking through different literature and I cannot seem to find it. But it was used, and that talks about both groups that prefer their own sex relationships. And I just don't know.
A word in English?
Yeah.
No, I wasn't being cute.
And it's been used, and I can't seem to find it. But
The only things that are springing to my mind as you asked it immediately are words that were translated from German in the beginning of the 20th century. You know, invert or third sex or what have you.
It may have been. I don't know. But I didn't look where the word was originated from. I knew that. There was a word for it. And the reason I was looking for that, or being able to deal with that, I think that sometimes that word needs to be used, because I think a lot of times that I think the word homosexual is used in a lot of ways that it shouldn't be used, or placed on people that should be placed upon. And so therefore, I think that word needs to be used so the group can be.
Mm-hmm. Well, the one that I really like, because there are, I think now we're becoming aware of the fact that in different cultural constructs, sexuality is constructed differently. Sexual identity or sexual identities are not the same as in the dominating culture in the United States, even cultures within this country. And so there's a variety of terminologies. I'll talk about that tomorrow when I talk about queer spiritualities and transgressing and transgressing. Trans, T-R-A-N-C-E. That's just to throw that out to make it rest. But there is a term that is used historically in the African American community that I find so rich, and that's in the life. And in the life included all kinds of people. I mean, not just what we would define as gay men or bisexual men or lesbians or bisexual women or whatever. It included people, I mean, all people who were in the life, who were living, who were a little bit on the edge, you know,
people in the arts, people in theater, commercial sex workers, everybody. And the term life, which has such a vibrance to it, and I really start to use that a lot, talking about in the life experience. Mm-hmm.
Another term I hear it a lot, and I use as well, that I find sometimes very appropriate is family.
Mm-hmm.
Have you heard
yeah,
that one?
Yeah.
Their family.
Yeah. See, one thing, if you come to know me over time, one thing that I'm always very careful about is to not walk into somebody's question that's not my question. Okay? To not walk into a question and try to give it an answer. I have to say that I have to reframe that question. Because in the way in which this society is organized, in the way in which the workplace is organized, in the way in which the economy is organized, there is an oligarchy that has control of everything. Now, if I'm a white man and I went to Williams College or Harvard or Yale and I belong to such and such a group and so on and so forth, and then I apply for a job at a big law firm in somewhere, Des Moines, let's say, I'm trying to be in my context. I get an extra push because I'm a white man that went to school with, you know, Bob, who's the vice president of the firm. Now, no one thinks of that as being an extra push, all right? And the way things are structured now has come into place through giving advantage and favoring certain people. What I say in response to that is that the whole way of organizing and structuring the workplace has to be redone, all right? It has to be redone. Because why, you see, even the fact you still have to give an extra push, that still means that the people on top in control are not the women, not the people of color, not the queer people, all right? And there is a glass ceiling. You can only go so far if you are one of those things. You can be a token and make it up through. And as long as who is in control stays in control, that's the way that it's going to be. So I advocate for a complete restructuring of it and a diversity that really reflects it. I mean, why don't you see a lot of women who are heads of universities? You don't see it that often. I mean, it's still, even now, disproportionately, women are underrepresented in the academy. And women's academic work is not taken as seriously as men's academic work. Now, you might legislate to let in X number of women or X number of people of color in your faculty, but by virtue of the very fact that you legislated in that way indicates that there is something wrong in the system, and that just say, okay, we're gonna put one Latina here and one, you know, Jewish woman from India here, because we have a couple categories there with her, and you know, let's just throw in she's bisexual on top of it. And then someone else, you fall into something that just continues to feed that system. That way of working. I mean, I feel that very strongly because I'm a person who would fall under one of those things, all right? And that no matter how brilliant
brilliant my career has been, no matter how brilliant my education, so on and so forth, there are impediments placed on my being hired because I'm black, because I'm queer, because I'm da 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 da, all those other things. All right? That I don't have equality of access. And the people in control, in positions of power, saying that they're going to take a few tokens, that does not create equality of access.
I really like your idealism, but that'd be false to say that you seem to be an idealist.
Well, everyone thinks I'm, as school, everyone thinks I'm just depressingly cynical.
But in respect to that, I just find you to be idealist, and because of that, I think that your freedom on the collegiate level, university level, to come out and be queer is very acceptable. They're not looking for middle school teachers that are saying that they're lesbian. So you seem to have that over me. But I'm very interested in your, you said that rural queers and city queers that join the military is not the right way to go. Where's your, give me a good idea.
I'm
joining your bandwagon, yeah, to what could be alternative.
Uh-huh. No, I didn't say that it was not the right way. I raised that question very existentially. I think it's very important to understand where speakers and thinkers come from, all right? That one just don't pull idea out of the air. That's why in the beginning I situated myself very clearly and talked about my experience. And my life partner, who was an African-American, gay-identified bisexual man, who wanted to be an archaeologist, who was a sharecropper's son from Durham, North Carolina, was told that if he joined the military, they would send him to Germany and that he could study. And he joined the military because no one in his high school bothered to give him any information about how to apply to a college and get financial aid. And so he joined the military. Now he was an anarchist and he was an anti-militarist. But he joined the military because that was the only way he thought he could get an education, which he did not get. Because once he got in the military, they didn't give it to him. All right? That's why I say that. Why are people made to believe that that is an option? And what I would say, I'm all for the creation of a national civil service. I mean, not like a bureaucratic civil service, but where you can, for example, you can work for 2 years, you can work for the National Gay and Lesbian Task Force in setting up an office, a Fight the Right office in Iowa. Things like that, grassroots work that could be subsidized. I mean, I know that's really crazy, but you ask me and I'll just go with it, okay? But the other thing I want to say also about, I think it's really important to understand, again, something about my context, because it's true, I am a university professor, and I'm out in that context, but there has to be some reason why out of thousands of professors, I'm the only one that's out, all right? I mean, I'm not teaching a white school. Howard University is a black university. Howard University is extremely conservative. Howard University only in the last 20 years got a brown-skinned black man as president. Because before that, we used to have presidents who could pass for white. Howard University just now this year has Oshala, which is the only lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender student organization in any predominantly African-American institution of higher education. I was invited to speak at Morehouse College and the invitation was rescinded because they could not guarantee the safety of my life. So all that's to say that, he's a professor, he's got dreads, but he can, do all that. I walk in a landmine, and on top of that, I teach in a divinity school, which, although is non-denominational, believe it or not, and they gave me tenure. The goddess is the foot. The goddess is alive, magic is the foot. In the divinity school is a non-denominational school, but that is very profoundly, conservatively Christian. All right? So I'm in a very isolated position. I just share very briefly, we have a discussion in faculty meeting on sexuality from the biblical perspective. And I was very uncomfortable in the discussion, and I shared with my colleagues who are, they're liberals. And I hate liberals. Liberals make me very nervous. Because they're like, well, why are you talking about homophobic? We're not homophobic, in the same way nice white people will say, like, well, we're not racist. You're sitting here. We're letting you sit here and talk to us. And one of my colleagues had done a presentation talking about how the Hebrew Bible was very positive on sexuality. And I was like, okay, I do read Hebrew. Maybe she has a different version than I do. I said, well, you can only say that if you're saying that heterosexual, procreative, male sexuality in certain restricted confines, relationally, can be seen as positive, then okay, well, you're not really good to see that. But here I was in a situation where I was hearing other people talk about my issues, and what I had to say, they didn't want to take seriously because, well, that's his stuff, so he's obviously not objective on that. And it's very, I'm not in a very comfortable place. What does comfort me in my context is that students have now begun to come out. So I have a good community of queer students within the school because I'm the, the faculty advisor for the with the queer student group, and they say, well, you're so crazy. If we ever do anything, any kind of visibility action, we'll just say, oh, he made us do it. We didn't know.
One of the problems that a group on campus here called Men Against Rape and Sexism encounters is that the men that they talk to don't have a sense of their power, just like whites don't have a sense of their privilege or heterosexual sex. And when I first started talking with some of the men of ours, they were thinking of power as like a bad word. And so it's sort of like, oh, well, I don't have any power. And I was just wondering if you could talk about both the sort of positive and negative aspects of power and how we can help people realize the power they have so that they can use it properly and, and give some of it away if they need to. Mm-hmm.
Well, I think that there are different kinds of power, or different articulations of power, let me put it that way. There's power from within, from power that might be acknowledged by the group, whatever the group is, or the community, whatever the community is, and a power that is exercised within that. Then there is power over. There is power over, and it's because that there are, that's a very summary description, because there's all kind of shades of power. But often people of goodwill, when they hear the word power, they think of power over, and they say, well, I don't have power over. But very often, those who say that the most quickly are the ones who do have power over, all right? Now, that might be implied power over, all right? Power that's conferred on them by their gender or their class or their social role or whatever. Not necessarily that they say, well, I have this power or I have this privilege. And what I find extremely helpful is that men, for example, stick to that paradigm, okay? That men who do have the understanding of what male privilege and what male power are, that those men work with other men around seeing those issues, all right? That white men work with white men on things, on both on racism and on sexism or heterosexism and so forth. When people say
People think that because they have power, then they're a bad person. And since they think of themselves as being a good person or a nice person, then they don't have power. And as long as they don't admit that they have power, they can't let go of it. So, you know, I found myself in an interesting situation in discussing this with some white men, and this white man got very upset that I would imply that he had any kind of power, this, that, and the other, then he told me this, he told me that, and so on and so forth. Then I just issued a very simple challenge to him. I said, okay, let's go downtown. And you tell them that you're a university professor, and I'll tell them I'm a university professor, and let's see which of the two of us they believe. And the answer was obvious. Now that's a kind of power, that's a kind of privilege that people don't, that they don't even think about because they're so used to it, right? There's an issue not just of defining what various shades or types of power are or privilege, but also beginning to do an inventory of them, you know? And without getting trapped in breastfeeding or dolorism, because that immobilizes, that paralyzes. In this, back in this famous Unitarian Universalist group, one of the ministers said, well, I'm one of the bad guys. I'm a white, well-educated, middle-class, heterosexual male. I said, well, first, the first problem there is that I never said you were a bad guy. And I didn't ask for you to say you're a bad guy. And you saying you're a bad guy does not do anything for me. And then he asked, well, but what should I do if I want to work in solidarity with people of color? I said, you know, what is, he asked, what was his struggle to be? I said, well, I can't tell you that. I'm not a straight, white, middle-class, well-educated man. I don't know that. I know what my struggle is. All I can tell you is what Audre Lorde used to say. You have to name your struggle. You have to see what your struggle is. You have to see what work you need to do within your own space. You know? But the power thing goes in the same thing in the recognition or the lack of recognition of diversity or the lack of diversity. For example, just in a group, you know? I mean, it's a privilege to be in a group completely of your own and not have to even think that there's something wrong in the picture. I mean, that is a form of privilege. Because when you're a person of color and you go into a room, you're painfully aware of the fact that you're the only one of your kind, or they're just a handful of you in that space. Power, privilege for me, for example, means recognizing the fact that we have a monolithic concept of culture in this country, all right? That there's just generic United States culture. Now, people of color know various forms of white American culture because we have grown up in your houses. We have gone to your schools, we have cleaned for you, we have taken care of you, we have worked for you, we have done all of those things. But most white people don't know our cultures, except as they see them portrayed in stereotypical fashions in the media. That's a form of power. That's why I'm always very supportive when white students come to Howard to study. But I always tell them also that, you know, again, this power thing. Well, when you're used to being a white man and just, you know, whenever you want to raise your hand and say something, just raise your hand and say it. When you're in a black school being taught by a black woman with all black people in the class, and you're the only white boy in there, you get by with that maybe once or twice. And no one even has to call you on it verbally, it's just like, that's a cultural thing. But there's an issue of power and privilege as a white man to subvert the authority of this black woman, all right, in a black context, instead of saying, all right, I need to maybe, in this course, I need to develop home my listening skills, you know? I would need to learn how to be
in this kind of setting and here. And some people are very successful at that. And they say it's a very painful process for them, though, because they have, like, you know, in one course, in one semester, they're trying to unlearn a whole life's way of behaving. But it, that strikes me so poignantly in the classroom, the way that the dynamic of power and privilege in that sense, and how white students, for example, another example of a white student, who comes to class basically when, at the time at which she feels like coming. I mean, she walks into the room when she feels like it, and she has a reputation of getting up. She never finishes a semester, and she just leaves. When she, oh, okay, gotta go now. She just gets up and leaves. Well, it's very clear that she has a problem with black people. Unfortunately, I'm not the only teacher who's had this experience with her, because I would, you know, personalize it. But I've heard from other colleagues. Now, that to me is a very good example. What black student in their right mind would sit in class in Harvard or Yale or Radcliffe or Vassar and just come waltzing into class 30 minutes late and leave 45 minutes before class ended? I mean, it would never cross our mind to do something like that, because we know people think that we come late anyway. We're not smart. You know, we can't pay attention. You know, we're doomed to fail, et cetera, and so forth. I mean, there's a whole set of criteria that inform our behavior in a setting like that, and we, where we have to think about that. And a privilege and power, I do what I want to do. This is not important enough for me to have to focus. And so part of that letting go of that power is recognizing, oh, maybe there is something aberrant in my behavior and something I need to change in my behavior to reflect a consistency with some discourse that I might have.
Earlier you said you made a statement about the lesbian bisexual women being harassed and abused by gay bashers. Personally, I feel like a lot of men's problems with lesbian women is part of that patriarchal ideal that women need men to succeed at anything. And I feel like it's all on a sexual level. And to go that extra step and to say, I don't need you to get a job, I don't need you to get an education, and I still don't need you for sex, is really what takes it to that.
Mm-hmm.
Level.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, that's what I said. Thank you. You put it in other words, but that's exactly, I mean, it's the ultimate threat to this male